Brendan Dassey trial transcript day 8, continuing on page 79. Okay, and I think that's what I was talking about. You talked about your qualifications on a direct examination, and you have indicated that this is the first time that you've ever presented this suggestibility theory or these suggestibility findings before a jury. Isn't that true? That is true. And this isn't it also true, doctor, that to your knowledge, since you're a forensic psychologist, you may know this, this is the first time ever in Wisconsin that this kind of testimony has been offered to a jury? Attorney Freeman, I would object. I don't think that's necessarily accurate. Attorney Kratz, if he knows, judge, if he doesn't know, I'll, the court. With that stipulation, go ahead, you can answer. The witness, I don't honestly know. Attorney Kratz, all right. The fact is, though, doctor, that when you talked about other psychologists that do this kind of work, and I, and that's a quote that I wrote down, if I can go back to the prior question, I misstated. Okay. I did testify on one occasion up in Wausau, and it was before a jury regarding this very matter. I forgot, I'm sorry. Back to my original question, when you talked about others doing this kind of work, do you know of other psychologists in the state of Wisconsin who are going around offering suggestibility testimony to juries? Going around and offering, I don't know of other psychologists who are conducting such evaluations and providing information like this to the court. Although they may exist, I don't know. All right, well, you told this jury about how well read you are, at least how you keep up on this particular area of forensic psychology. If that was something that was commonly done, or even in Wisconsin, if it was something done, you'd likely know about it, wouldn't you? If it was commonly done, that's true. Let's talk about the specific tests that you did perform. I interposed some objections about the Wechsler test and how it was scored or how it was scaled. Do you remember those objections? I do. The original chart that was placed up there found Brendan to have a full-scale Wechsler intelligence score of 81, and at least your suggestion was that that fit within the borderline intelligence category. My question for you, doctor, is under the Wechsler scale itself, under the Wechsler analysis of that particular IQ score, and I think you correct yourself that he in fact fits in a category called low average, isn't that right? He's in the lower end of the low average according to Wechsler's norms, true. All right, now I'm going to be skipping pretty far ahead, but your eventual opinion is going to be based in large part on something called the Gudjonsson suggestibility scale, which as I understand includes a consideration of an individual's IQ level. Is that true? That's a mischaracterization of my testimony. You said in large part it would be based on Gudjonsson, and I said I couldn't assign a percentage, that it was relying on all the different tests, collateral data, and interview. The term vulnerability to suggestibility, does that depend upon IQ levels, or at least that's one of the factors that you have to consider? Yes. To render that opinion or to have a particular subject fit within a category that is consistent with vulnerability to suggestibility, is it a fair statement that that hypothesis is furthered or that hypothesis is supported if an individual has a borderline intellectual capability or borderline IQ rather than low average? Or am I overstating that distinction between Wechsler and your original testimony? I think you're overstating it. All right. The percentile is what's most important to consider, that standard across the Wechsler norms and the DSM norms. All right, in your performance of the IQ tests, you mentioned that that was important to you. In other words, getting a relatively accurate read of Brendan's current IQ level was important. True. Is that what you said? I think you mentioned that because this was such an important case and because of the opinion that you wanted to give to this jury, coming up with an accurate value, or at least a range, was important for you. That's fair, isn't it? It's fair. All right. The Wechsler intelligence scale, even the abbreviated version that you give, how many subtests are included in that particular test? There are either two can be administered or four can be administered. I administered two. What does that mean? Either two or four can be administered. I assume one can be administered. Isn't that true? That's not true. Why did you administer two instead of the four sub-tests of that? I wanted to obtain an overall IQ estimate and compare it to the Kaufman brief, its brief intelligence test, to see if there was consistency. If there was no consistency, then I would have found the need to go into more comprehensive intellectual testing. As I indicated before, the interviewing and the testing process determines what tests I administer to. Was this anything that prevented you from administering all four of the subtests for this IQ test to Mr. Dassey? No. You next talked about, or at least in your report, you talked about the 16PF, which I think you described as a called it a test that evaluates quote unquote normal characteristics, at least under general circumstances. Is that a fair characterization? It's a as opposed to the MMPI or something that looks at the more deviant or more problematic individuals. I would agree with what you said, except you said under normal circumstances. I mean, I guess I'm not understanding your question. I beg your pardon. Well, we can get right to the conclusions of the 16PF. Did you agree with the findings of your or of the results from the 16PF test? I found them to be consistent with the other test results and the result of the evaluation. I assume you've been asked to bring your file and the results with you here to court, is that right? Yes, I have. If you'd be so kind, doctor, as to turn to your results of the 16PF test, and as you're doing that, or as you're looking for that, I'm sure you can also answer this. How was this test scored? In other words, do you score it, or do you send it away to be scored by somebody else? It's computer scored from my office, and the scores are then interpreted into a report. Bear with me, please. I will. I'm sorry. And so the jury understands what you're looking at. It is a printout, a report, if you will, of the results of the administration of the examination to Brendan. Is that right? It's a computer-generated report of hypothesis regarding individuals who have scales that he obtained on this particular questionnaire. Okay, if you'd be so kind as to turn to page three, then the very last category is called cognition and communication. Do you see that? Yes. Within this report, it suggests that although not necessarily a measure of general intelligence, it does test one cognitive skill, namely the ability to manipulate verbal concepts. I was curious as to what that meant. Maybe you can describe that for the jury. What is the ability to manipulate verbal concepts? Well, I can only tell you what the test, it's a component of the test where there are analogies such as a pear is to an apple as a dog is to fill in the blank, and maybe there'd be cat, tree, and whatever. That's an example. There are also this is not on the test, but for the sake of discussion, please fill in what would be the proper number in sequence. If you have the numbers 1, 3, and 5, and then they have 6, 7, 8, and 9, and you're supposed to pick the all right. Correct answer. I mean, and so it does not yield an IQ score. It just yields a general idea of how they answered those questions. It's a personality test. It's not an IQ test. But this report, if believed, suggests that Brendan does function adequately in his ability to manipulate verbal concepts. Isn't that what it says? Well, it was says in its entirety, as well as scale, does not necessarily measure general intelligence. It does test one cognitive skill, namely the ability to manipulate verbal concepts. In this area, he appears to function adequately on this particular scale, which is not an IQ test. Okay, do you agree with that statement? No. Really? You act surprised. Do you know what the term cherry picking means? I do. And cherry picking, at least in the concept of professionals who testify, is they present to juries what might support their client's position, but they keep from them or they don't report the things that don't or that might undermine their opinion. That's a fair characterization of that term. That is true. By the way, anywhere in your report or your conclusions, did you include the 16PF conclusion that Brendan's ability to manipulate verbal concepts was of an adequate functioning level? Did you include that anywhere in your report? I did not include that computer-generated hypothesis in my report. That's correct. Next test that you had Brendan perform, or the next one that you talked about, was something called the State Trait Anger Expression Inventory. You're familiar, I know, with that particular test, and in fact, in your report dated November 15, 2006, you discuss how the State Trait Anger Expression Inventory factored into or was considered by you in your ultimate analysis and conclusion. That's true, isn't it? That's true. In your written report, that is, the report that you have provided to counsel and to court, you indicate the following, and I'll just read this to you. You're not going to have to look at this. I'm sure you'll recognize the sentence. As read, the State Trait Anger Expression Inventory was further used to assess for features of anger, passivity, and anxiety. You remember writing that? Yes. And in fact, did you take the results of this particular instrument and apply it to the features that you suggest in your report, that is anger, passivity, and anxiety? I'm sorry, I considered the results. Now, the State Trait Anger Expression Inventory, first of all, is that a test? Is that something that psychologists normally call a test or not? No, we normally call it an inventory. All right, the difference between inventory and tests are, and correct me if I'm wrong, but a test are something that have norms. That is, it's something that can be objectively scored. Isn't that true? No, tests more are synonymous with tests of IQ, tests of achievement abilities, academic abilities. The personality inventories are more to do with assessing personality traits, emotional problems, that sort of thing, as compared to the IQ part. All right, let me just ask you then about the State Trait Anger Expression Inventory. Do the results of that particular test have norms to compare it to? Yes. By the way, the term anxiety, which you express in your report, was one characteristic that you used this instrument to examine. Is there anything in this particular instrument that talks about anxiety at all? I might have been confused. As a state trait, there are two tests by Charles Spielberger out of Florida. One primarily measures anxiety, one measures anger. Correct. And I may have confused the two and thought that anger expression inventory also included anxiety. But it doesn't, does it? From the way you're looking at me, I don't think it probably does. Why, if anxiety was something that you thought was important to gauge with this young man, which I think your report indicates it is, why didn't you give the state trait anger, or excuse me, state trait anxiety inventory instead of the anger inventory? Because I gave another test that would measure that on a variety of anxiety levels, and that would be the Minnesota Multiphasic Personality Inventory / adolescent version. A perfect segue to my next questions, Doctor. The MMPIA, or the adolescent version, I think you cautioned before that you can't really look at any specific answer to any specific question, that might be somehow misleading, and I was confused as to why that would be. Can you explain that again? By reading one particular response, one can then conclude that can be used to draw definitive conclusions, and taking it out of context is very likely to mislead a jury, and I'm sure you wouldn't want the jury to be misled. I'm sure I wouldn't either, and that's why I'm going to ask you some of these specific questions. Brendan, when provided these questions, or when asked questions on what's called the MMPI, was asked a series of 478 true-false questions. He could either say true or he could say false on the answers. Isn't that right? That's right. Now, as you told this jury there, after the results are obtained, there's various scales. In other words, how he answers questions on particular answers, or I guess more appropriately stated, the combination of certain answers can oftentimes be considered by trained professionals, and some tendencies might be able to be developed regarding characteristics, personality traits. That's fair, isn't it? True. Did you assume that Brendan, when asked these 478 questions, gave truthful or accurate responses, at least as he believed them to be? It was my conclusion that they were accurate because there are validity scales on the MMPI and on most personality inventories that show whether a person is answering in a straightforward fashion, minimizing or exaggerating. All right. And if those are scores, the validity scores are so abnormal to such a degree that it shows that person was extremely or exaggerating, then I can't interpret the pro I don't You can't interpret the profile because the scores either over or underestimate emotional problems. Now, in the interpretation of these answers or the profiles, this particular instrument allows trained psychologists to look at various scales. You talked about one that included shyness or social anxiety or social alienation. Is that correct? Shyness was on the 16PF, social alienation was on the MMPIA. All right, social and social avoidance as well? That's true. What's that scale called, by the way, when you test for those particular characteristics? Which scale are we looking at? Social avoidance. Have any other name to it on the MMPI, often referred to as the zero scale? No, not at all. That's a different scale. That's social introversion. But there are other supplementary scores, and so the social avoidance comes from the social introversion scale. It's in parentheses SI2. It's one component of the social introversion clinical scale. All right, and so this jury understands there were other things that you could have scored this test for. There are other personality characteristics that you could have rendered opinions about in this case, but that you chose not to. Is that correct? Although there are hundreds of scales that could be scored, I used the ones that are recommended by the University of Minnesota and the original test constructors in James Butcher and Drs. Archer and Drs. Ben Porath, among others. For what? I mean, you must have been looking for something. No. You were looking for suggestibility. No, I was just issues, weren't you? I'm sorry for not letting you go ahead. I was not looking. I was looking for information designed to address those questions, and there are a broad range of questions that are computer scored that come back, or actually are done on my computer, electronically sent to Minnesota and back, and I could count the number of scales. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31. The reporter, please slow down. The court, slow down. Just take your time. The witness, sorry, sir. Kratz, there's lots of scales that's, I can go on, and I'm just, so I would guess that 70 scales are on what is called the, from the MMPI, it's from the extended score report for the MMPIA. And of those over 70 scales, how many did you score for? All of them were scored. Oh, good. Then I can ask you some questions about the ones we haven't heard about, I assume. Sure. Good. By the way, you were asked to provide, and I assume you brought with you the individual questions that Brendan was asked, and you have available for you individual answers that he gave. Isn't that true? I have the individual answers he gave, but I gave the test questions, even though it's a violation of my contract with the University of Minnesota. I provided that to the attorney that retained me. All right, but you've got the answers then with you at least. Yes, I do. When was this test administered to Brendan? November 13, 2006. Who was it administered by? Me. Did you record the answers that Brendan gave when you asked him specific questions? At this point, counsel, I don't recall whether I read the questions to him or if I had him read the questions and answered them. All right.